Now, if you look in the Bible, Gideon's victory over the Midianites has to rank up to a pretty high 300 over approximately 100,000. Then David's victory over Goliath was cool. The sack of the throne by the Vandals in 455 AD was surely unexpected. America's victory over the British at Yorktown has to be way up there. In fact, do not know their history. That's a war that the Americans should have never won. I'm just in the last stages of finishing the book, the title of which is Almost a Miracle, about the War of Independence. Quite frankly, folks, we should have never beaten Britain. It should have never happened. God provided that miracle. It was truly a miracle. Then there's the Texas victory over Santa Ana. And then there's Robert E. Lee's masterful stroke, Chancellorsville, the Union victory at Gettysburg, and the victory at Crazy Horse at the Little Bighorn, just to name a few. More recently, there was the Battle of Midway, and the Russian victory at Stalingrad, and the landings at Normandy on D-Day, and MacArthur, Gold, Gamble, and Chausson. There have been a lot of great victories, but none of those great. We have gathered this morning to celebrate the greatest victory, one that took place just outside Jerusalem. The greatest victory was whenever death. Such a victory has to rank the greatest of all victories. These victories will be scaled as the cross culminated that Sunday morning when he literally walked away from the grave. Our text tells us this morning that the last enemy we defeated is death. And it's the one enemy over which humankind has no control. Not death. Despite all of our medical advances in technology, we still cannot defeat death, and it remains our great enemy. Turn with me to this section, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Absolutely proof. Well, let's ask this question also. Okay, we believe this. Jesus rose from the grave. What does that have to do with us? What does the resurrection mean to us? Well, first, if Jesus is alive, then our circumstances can be overcome. Paul goes to great lengths in this chapter, one of the longest chapters in all of the New Testament, to tell us that the resurrection is an undisputed fact. William Proctor is a graduate of Harvard and Harvard University Law School. He is a respected journalist, a former legal and criminal sports reporter. Proctor, who has, by the way, no religious acts crime one way or another, claims that if the resurrection happened today, the story would be reported as the journalistic equivalent of the Holy Grail. It would be a memorable story, the big one, and it would dominate not only the headlines, but also the front pages of what few newspapers survive in today's culture. And Proctor also claims that the news story would be the greatest in history, stopping even events such as the end of the Second World War, the first step of a man on the moon, and the disintegration of the Soviet Union. And using investigative journalistic tactics, Proctor believes that the story would be reported as an actual and real event. Now, I can stand here this morning and give you 10 or 12 compelling evidences for the resurrection, but I don't have time. Evidences that actually existed at the time of the resurrection. Even the late New Testament scholar at the very liberal University of Chicago, Norman Ferrara, admitted, the more we study the tradition with regards to the appearances, the firmer the rock begins to appear upon which they are based. Thus, Jesus can overcome his circumstances, having died a real death and being buried in a real grave. This same Jesus can overcome our circumstances, no matter what they may be. Think of the circumstances that you're in today. Think of what you may be facing today. Think of how you're going to overcome those circumstances. Think of Jesus resurrected. There was a letter that was sent from the Department of Health and Human Services a few years ago to a resident in Greenfield County, South Carolina. This is the way the letter read, and I quote, "Your food stamps will be stopped effective in March because we received notice you passed away. May God bless you. You may reapply if your circumstances change." Well, the resurrection tells us that our circumstances can change because Jesus is alive. We can even look at death and not be afraid, though people today take death less seriously than ever before. A very popular philosopher / lecturer / writer was discussing death as speech he was giving, and he drew great applause from the audience when he scolded those who still believe that death is an enemy, and he said for them to think of themselves free. They must turn loose and give and fall to the ground and become so much mold so that truly might be something. Well, it may be a very stimulating and sophisticated idea to a formerly dressed, well-educated group who just marched bill and felt good about everything. Those who have passed it for years. I have been forced to witness what death does to those same gifted and exciting personalities. So forgive me if I still think that death is our one unconquered enemy. and that nothing, and there is nothing that makes the resurrection better. Good. Paul says here again, verse 26. Look at that verse yet again, what he says. Verse 26 says, the last enemy to be destroyed is, in fact, death. Now, until very recently, I realized it's raining. It's the elephant in the room that nobody wants to talk about. So I hear the rain, I hear the rain, I hear the rain. But until very recently, people lived their lives with dying in mind. But in the modern era, death is the great unmentionable. Psychologists claim that the majority of people today refuse to face death, including even going for an annual checkup physically, lest they confront their own mortality. Now, why is that? Well, quite frankly, death is the inescapable reality and a fearful reality to those without Jesus Christ, and his work on the cross culminated and consummated in the resurrection. Believers do not face death with confidence because we are blind to its heart. Neither do we face death because we've not stopped to think about its implications. No, neither does our confidence rest on so-called messages from the dead through seances and all that other kind of spooky stuff, or philosophical investigations into the survival of the human ego. Christians instead look unambiguously resurrection of Jesus Nazareth. Such a victory tells us that our circumstances can change because Jesus is alive. That's the victory. Philip, born with Down syndrome. He was a pleasant child, happy it seemed, but increasingly aware of the differences of the children. Philip went to Sunday school at his local church. His teacher taught the third grade class with Philip and nine other 8-year-old boys. Well, you know, you were once 8 years old, and you had 8-year-old boys and girls. And Philip, with all of his differences, was not readily accepted. The teacher created and tried to help that group. 8-year-olds, they learned, they laughed, they played together, and they really cared about one another, though it was hard for them as 8-year-olds to say that they cared about one another out loud. The teacher could see it, and he knew it. He also knew that Philip was never really smart. Philip didn't choose, nor did he want to be the way he was. Just that. Had a marvelous idea for the Sunday after Easter. He went out and he bought 10 big plastic bowls, kind of like what our children did this morning. The children loved him when he brought them to the room. Each child was to get one. It was a beautiful spring day in our life today. And so he assigned for each child to go outside and hunt for symbols of new life. Put that symbol into the egg and then bring it back to the classroom. Then they would open up eggs, share their new life symbols, and one by one. It was glorious. It was confusing. It was wild. The children ran all around everywhere getting their symbols and rushed to get back to the classroom. All the children stood around the table and the teacher began to open them. There was a flower. They moved all. He opened another one. And there was a little butterfly. And the girls said, beautiful, because boys 8 years old find it hard to say beautiful. He opened another. There was fresh, green grass. The teacher opened the next one. The other children, his 8-year-old girl said, that's not fair. That's stupid. Somebody didn't do it right. He felt good. nothing there. I did so do it. I did do it. It's empty. Family had known he was born, he would never live out a full life. Many other things had been wrong with his mind. So late in July, with an infection that most normal children were quickly shrugged off, he died. 9 8-year-old marched up to the altar, knocked the flowers, cover up the stark reality of death. 9 8-year-old with their Sunday school teacher marched right up to the altar and laid on it. Empty, old, hearted, like we always expected to be, we always planned to be there were several things. Traditionally, every Easter Sunday. I don't like tradition, but this particular song is a great one. All because Jesus is alive, our fears can be banished. I've always liked what novelist Frederick Beecher said about the resurrection. We can say, that the story of the resurrection means simply that the teachings of Jesus are immortal, like the plays of Shakespeare, the music of Beethoven, and their wisdom and their truth. Or we can say that the resurrection means that the spirit of Jesus is undying, that he himself lives on among us in the way that Socrates does, in all the good he left behind, and how people try to follow his great example. Or we can say that the language in which the gospel describes the resurrection of Jesus is the language of poetry, and as such, is not just literally, but rather pointing to truth more profound than literal. But in the case of the resurrection, this simply does not apply, because there's no story about the resurrection in the New Testament. Except in the most fragmentary way, the resurrection really isn't described at all. There's no poetry about it. Instead, it's simply claim as a fact, Christ is risen. Our text that we read a few moments ago, go back to verses 24 and 25, alludes to a time when Christ will hand over the kingdom to God the Father after he has defeated all dominion and authority and power. Again, note what we are told in verses 24 25, if you look up here behind me, okay? We're told that he must reign until he puts all of his enemies under his feet. We're also told in Paul's letter to the Colossians that Jesus has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and that he has disarmed the powers and the authorities and made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them at the cross. His resurrection was the exclamation point on that victory, the final conquering act. but we're still afraid. Most of us are afraid because we do not feel fear. I read an article some years ago about an employee in a store in Massachusetts who found a $20 bill on the washroom floor. There was a note on the top. Help! Get that! Call Highway Patrol! Note said on one side, a list of two Oklahoma phone numbers. My car, green and blue Oklahoma, it said on the other side of the note. So the police were notified, and when they determined the names of the people to whom the phone numbers belong, an elderly couple by the name of Floyd and Rita Ruck. They put out an all-points bulletin. Media published photos and descriptions of the couple, missing couple. The two daughters sat anxiously by their phone, waiting for news as the police conducted the search for 24 hours. And then a phone call was received at the office of Mr. Ruck. The office manager heard a familiar voice say, I'm sitting here in none of them. Missing man. The office manager asked him, you have no idea. He didn't. And when he and his wife found out, they were quite embarrassed. Turns out that his wife was feeling insecure about the drive back to Oklahoma that she would be making alone. So she had written out the kidnapped note, put it in her purse, just in case. And it had fallen out of her purse in that store. But who among us doesn't have concerns about security and terror? Yet another reminder. But our elaborate efforts to find security for ourselves sometimes seem silly, like Rita Ruff. Note what we're told in verse 22. The last enemy to be defeated. Then beginning with verse 55, I want you to note this again. You hear this chant. Sometimes I think we ought to repeat this again. out loud. Here we go. Read it together once again. Verse 55. O death, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. Thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord. Our greatest fear is that the one enemy we fight against, all of our medical and technological advances, we cannot defeat death. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ and his triumph over sin at the cross, death no longer has the upper hand, folks. For the believer, we can legitimately say that death is a defeated enemy. Jesus put it this way: I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. There is a town, a village, a friend's missionary, called Bay Mabanta. They passed a law barring any more burials in the town. The law said, and I quote, "It is forbidden without a cemetery plot to die on the territory of the community." But the law didn't stop people from dying. Many people died without a plot and were temporarily housed in friends' homes. The only law against dying that really works is on E.L. Moody, great 19th century evangelist, once said, "Someday you'll read in the papers that Moody is dead. Don't you believe a word of it. On that day, I shall be more alive than ever before." He wasn't talking about being resurrected at that moment himself. He was talking about the who he is inside this earth suit that houses the who we are will survive death. That's also what Winston Churchill, the legendary British leader, Churchill arranged. There were stately hymns, St. Paul's Cathedral, and Preston. But at the end of the service, Churchill had when they said the benediction, the jubilee, on the dome, on the top of the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral, on one side, played Pax, the universal signal. Then a bugler on the other side played Reveille, the military wake-up call. It was Churchill's way of communicating that while we say good night here, it's good morning up there. And why would he do that? Because he had trusted in Jesus Christ and said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he." When a person steps out of his own grave, he is anything he says he is, and he can do anything he says he can do. And that, folks, is the greatest victory. This is what we have come this morning to celebrate. Christ is risen. Now let me ask you to stand, and we're going to say that together as we end our service. Stand right now. On three. Let's do this right. We're going to say Christ is risen. All right? One, two, three. Christ is risen. Believe and believe it. Live it.